The senator from Texas.
Madam President, while many folks in Washington, D.C. remain ambivalent about what's happening along the southern border, I'm here to report that we are reaching a breaking point. Every month, Customs and Border Protection releases the total number of people who attempt to cross the southern border. The total includes those who cross illegally between the ports of entry, as well as those deemed inadmissible at a port of entry. Just to give you an idea of the size and scope of the numbers we've been dealing with, since June 2014, the month that President Obama referred to this as a humanitarian crisis, more than 66,000 individuals were encountered along the border. At that time, we thought 66,000 was a huge number, but it pales into comparison to what we are seeing now. Last month, more than 103,000 people attempted illegally cross the border. That's 103,000, up from 76,000 the previous month. I know a few weeks ago we got into a debate about what did and what did not constitute an emergency or crisis at the border. I don't care whether you call it a crisis or an emergency, but the entire system is breaking and it's unsustainable. This is the highest number of people attempting to enter the country that we've seen since 2007. And this mind-boggling figure represents the strain felt by the personnel, that is, U.S. government employees, whether they be Border Patrol or Customs or whoever, that are trying to manage the influx of the migrants. The men and women of CBP lack both the manpower and the facilities to appropriately respond. The already understaffed agency is reassigning personnel to try to make do. But 40% of the Border Patrol's manpower is spent processing migrants and providing care and transportation. And many of the agents are taken off their patrol line to do this work, leaving areas of the border vulnerable to exploitation by drug cartels and others. The detention centers where these migrants are housed and processed or being processed are relatively small facilities, not designed for these kind of huge numbers. They were originally built to house single adults for a short period of time, but the skyrocketing number of unaccompanied children and family units is now putting a serious strain on those resources. Last month alone, there were more than 53,000 families and nearly 9,000 unaccompanied children apprehended at the border. 53,000 families and 9,000 unaccompanied children. Customs and Border Protection simply lacks the facilities to hold these children or the personnel to provide appropriate care. And do we really want Border Patrol handing out juice boxes and diapers as opposed to interdicting dangerous drugs and other contraband coming into the United States? I don't think so. But we know they are desperately asking for additional detention space and staff to be able to manage the migrants in custody. And why is it so important that they be detained? Well, because if we engage in the practice that has come to be known as catch and release, then it is doubtful that we will ever see these migrants again, even though they will be notified of their time to appear in front of an immigration judge months and maybe even years into the future. They'll just simply melt into the landscape. And if they had bona fide reasons to claim asylum and it failed to appear for their hearing in front of an immigration judge, they waive those rights and they will be deported if they are ultimately located in the United States. We know that customs inspectors have been reassigned from their duty at ports of entry to do things like process migrants and provide transportation. And with fewer customs agents on the job, we're now seeing lengthy delays at the ports and checkpoints along the entire border. In Juarez, just right across from El Paso, Texas, truckers have reported sleeping in their vehicles so they don't lose their spot in line for hours and sometimes days. And I heard from some of the car manufacturers that require the flow of their supply chain across from Mexico and vice versa, that they literally are hiring aircraft to fly from Juarez to El Paso because it's faster, that 11-minute flight, than it is waiting for 24 hours in line. And many of our car manufacturers that depend on just-in-time inventory, when they can't get their inventory just in time but have to wait 24 hours, it disrupts their manufacturing line and endangers their business. And of course, it's easy to see how this could have a ripple effect on the entire border and American economy. This slowdown isn't just affecting businesses along the border. It has businesses across the country worried, as I said. Mexican products feed the supply chain for many manufacturers in the United States, and these slowdowns will affect production. While folks who live far away from the border may have just chosen to look the other way until now, they don't have a choice anymore. The system is breaking, and the ripples will soon be felt across the country unless members of Congress on both sides of the aisle work together and are serious about enacting a solution. We know what we need to do, but politics is preventing us from getting it done. It's time to provide our frontline officers and agents with the personnel and the resources and the legal authorities they need in order to do the job we've asked them to do. But without support from Congress, we're sending them into a losing battle, and we're setting our economy up for a disaster. Madam President, on another matter, when the Senate is in recess next week, I, like most of our colleagues here, will be returning to our states to talk to our constituents and hopefully to listen to what they have to say. But some of the things I'll be talking about as I travel from El Paso to Laredo include the Gear Up for Success Act with students, teachers, and school administrators. Gear Up seeks to increase college and career readiness for underrepresented and low-income students. It currently serves about 600,000 students nationwide, and Texans have benefited from the $885 million in Gear Up grants over the last 20 years. I'm glad I've had a chance to visit with some of my constituents in San Antonio and Harlingen about this bill and the incredible impact that Gear Up grants have had on their students. I guess I didn't fully appreciate the fact that a student really has to begin deciding in seventh grade what their course of study will be, because if they don't take their required courses or the prerequisite courses for other courses they're going to need in order to graduate or to get into college, they may miss the boat entirely. And many of these students come from families whose parents had never attended college, and they may be unaware of the requirement to take the right sort of course selection early on, as opposed to waiting until their junior or senior year when they begin to think about where to apply to college. This legislation would allow school districts to better cater to their students' specific needs rather than using a one-size-fits-all program, and it would reduce the local cost share required by half. I'm eager to hear from my constituents in El Paso and Laredo and talk about what else we can do in Washington to promote college and career readiness. We know that in a tight labor market with a booming economy, one of the things we hear about the most back home is the fact that that employers can't find adequately trained workers to work in the jobs that are available and return a good wage. So it's important that we continue to do everything we can, not only to promote education generally, but also career readiness for many of the well-paying jobs that are going wanting for a lack of qualified workers. I'll also take some time to visit the Center for Child Protection in Austin to discuss the Jenna Quinn Law. This would allow grants to train students and teachers and caregivers on identifying and reporting child sexual abuse. The bill is named for a courageous Texan and modeled after successful reforms in my state. And it's another great example of how we're working to bring the successful Texas model to the national level. And finally, I'll visit Dyess Air Force Base in Abilene, Texas, with my friend and colleague, Congressman Jody Arrington, for a briefing on their latest operations and the recent news from the Air Force that Dyess will be receiving the B-21, the next generation of strategic bombers. Dyess is the most dynamic bomber base in the country, and I'm glad the Air Force has chosen the future home for the B-21 squadrons, as well as weapons instruction courses and test squadrons. It just makes a lot of sense. And I look forward to spending time at home with my constituents. These conversations drive my work here in the Senate, and I'm eager to get more feedback on how these bills could make positive changes in their lives and in the lives of all of my constituents in the state. Now, Madam President, on one final matter, this week Texas lost a true hero. Lieutenant Colonel Richard Cole passed away on Tuesday at the ripe old age of 103 in my hometown of San Antonio. For Texans and so many Americans, Lieutenant Colonel Cole, or Dick, as his friends and brothers in arms called him, symbolized one of the most remarkable groups from the greatest generation in World War II, and that would be the Doolittle Raiders. The group is named for then Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle, who in April of 1942 fearlessly led 16 B-25 bombers and 80 crew members on a strike targeting factories and military installations in and around Tokyo. This was actually Dick's first mission, and he was Jimmy Doolittle's co-pilot. After the attack by the Japanese on Pearl Harbor, this mission wasn't just of tactical importance, it was a major morale boost for our nation. The Air Force Chief of Staff, David Goldfein, recently said, "Those 80 intrepid men changed the course of history. They executed a one-way mission without hesitation and against enormous odds." The mission was, as you might imagine, perilous. Doolittle's Raiders took off from the USS Hornet with barely enough runway to get airborne. In fact, Doolittle and Cole's aircraft only had 467 feet to take off in an aircraft that wasn't designed to launch from an aircraft carrier. The airplanes inadvertently took off 170 miles further from Japan than they planned, so they had insufficient fuel to make it to their landing fields in China. As a result, Dick, then 26, with limited experience jumping out of aircraft, had to leap out of his B-25 into unknown territory. He later reported he gave himself a black eye when he pulled the ripcord and finally landed in the branches of a tree where he spent the night dangling. He later said, "They don't give Purple Hearts for self-inflicted injuries. I gave myself a black eye." But his heroism was certainly rewarded. He received the Distinguished Flying Cross for his role in the bombing, as well as the Bronze Star and the Air Medal. Then in 2015, Dick and his fellow Raiders received the Congressional Gold Medal. These men, as you might imagine, shared an incredible bond, and their lasting camaraderie was evident through one special tradition they shared. For each reunion, the crew would share a cognac in silver goblets. Each goblet was engraved with the Raiders' name, both right side up and upside down. After toasting to the men who had died since their last reunion, they would flip over the goblets of those who had passed away. At their final reunion in 2013, only four Raiders were left. After determining that this would be the final reunion due to their age and travel limitations, Dick delivered the last toast. Now, his silver goblet will be turned over, just as it was for the 79 brothers who left this earth before them. So today we remember the final Doolittle Raider for his incredible courage and sacrifice and a life well lived. America has lost another hero, but our country will never forget him. I send my condolences to Dick's family and friends, and especially his son, Rich, and daughter, Cindy. Madam President, I yield the floor, and I note the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.